But I wanted to look this afternoon at a couple of related parables. But to get to the parables, I've got to provide background for it. So I want to talk for a little while about some big picture kind of things. And that sets the context for how I understand what's going on in the parable. So bear with me because that's important. God, of course, in the beginning, God miraculously created all things. He creates everything, including humans, Adam and Eve, during the 6 days of creation. And the creation as he makes it, as it comes from his hand, it's an ideal place. It's a place in which all things are working as in the way God desired. But soon you have Adam and Eve, who are to be God's representatives on earth. They rejected his rule by disobeying him and by bringing sin into the human world. They were the doorway. They bring the sin into the human world, and by doing that, they spoiled, in some sense, God's very good creation. And as a result, the creation is not now the way it's supposed to be. It's no longer a paradise in which all things function and work together in peace and in harmony under God's rule. Instead, our world now, it includes things like anger and division and hatred and violence and destruction and death and decay and lying and stealing and suffering and sorrow and pain. That is the world we live in. It's a creation that is sick as a result of sin. It has fallen from its original state of glory, which is why Adam sinning in Christian theology is known as the fall. And the story of the Bible is the story of God's work through the people of Israel to rescue his creation, which includes mankind, from its fallen state. People are the high point of God's creation, but his rescue effort includes all of creation, because all of creation was harmed as a result of sin. That's why Paul says in Romans 8, 19, particularly 19 to 22, he says that creation itself looks forward to the day it will be freed from the consequences of human sin in which it has been entangled. It longs to be freed from that. And the scope and the breadth of Christ's healing work, it's also evident in Colossians chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, where Paul speaks of Jesus as the one through whom God reconciled all things to himself, making peace by the blood of the cross. And this scope and breadth of Christ's work is seen in Ephesians 1, 9 and 10, where Paul says the mystery of God's will for the administration of the fullness of the times is to bring all things together under Christ, the things in the heavens and the things on the earth. As he says in 2 Corinthians 1:20, for all the promises find their yes in him, in Jesus. Now the Old Testament, if you've been in my classes, none of what I'm saying to you is new. But always it's good to reinforce some of these things. And some of you aren't there. Some of you, in fact, may avoid my classes. No. That would not. Nah. That can't be right. But the Old Testament, it ends on a note of unfulfilled hope. I mean, it was clear that in one sense, God has always ruled the world from the time of creation. Right, he's on the heavenly throne. You see that like Psalm 11:4, Isaiah 6:1. He reigns over all. For instance, 1 Chronicles 16:31, Psalm 93:1, 96:10. But there's some sense, you see, in which his kingly rule is not being fully expressed, is not being fully exerted or asserted. He's allowing creation to go on out of step with his ultimate intention for it. He was, you see, in the Old Testament, allowing creation to continue in a state of sin and suffering that's contrary to his ultimate vision. That's not how it's going to be forever. And yet God, who's on the throne, the ruler of all things, is allowing his creation to go on in this state of sin and suffering. And so he's on the throne, but there is a sense in which he's not fully yet asserting his complete rulership so as to bring this fallen creation to its ultimate completion. But the prophets in the Old Testament, the prophets saw that a day was coming in which God would express his rulership of creation in a way in which all things would be brought into harmony and conformity with his ultimate purpose and will. His creation would be redeemed from the dreadful consequences of sin that had invaded it. This world of rebellion, sin, hostility, fragmentation would be rescued by God. It would be transformed by him into a true utopia, a perfect reality of love, joy, fellowship with God and with one another. And on that day, see, God would express his authority over creation in a day he's not doing at present. You see, he would fully assert his right as king and ruler, his sovereign power to bring creation to its ultimate fulfillment. And at that time, he will be king, as it says in Zechariah 14:9, in a manner unlike the present. Is he king now? Yes, he's king. But there is an unfulfilled sense in which one day he's going to fully assert that sovereignty and rulership to cure and rescue this fallen creation, to bring it into complete harmony with his will, and then that will be the eternal state. And the prophets saw that. They saw that day. Now, the Old Testament, it uses different imagery to speak of this blessed state that God is going to bring about, that he's going to create. And that imagery, it varies in how sharply it distinguishes that future blessed state from present existence. But all of the imagery says, informs relevant to ancient Jews, that a time of divine blessing is coming. It says that the failures and the sufferings of the present age would be put to rights by the coming of a new age. And in the first century, Israel was weak and poor and under the rule of pagans, the Romans. The people longed and prayed for the coming of God, for his final intervention, when he would set all things right and rule to the fullest extent, in the fullest sense, to the blessing of his people. In Mark 15:43, Joseph of Arimathea, he's described as one who was what? Waiting for the kingdom of God, or looking for the kingdom of God. They're longing, they're waiting. When, God? When? How long? We've been a long time waiting. We know the promises. When? And it's into that religious, social, and political environment that Jesus came saying, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. He comes saying, but if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. He says in Luke 17:21, for behold, the kingdom of God is among you. It is in your midst. Jesus was announcing the arrival in his person and ministry of God's final intervention in history, the ultimate expression of his kingly rule on the world. And that naturally created excitement. They've been longing for this. They've been waiting for this. And then here comes a guy saying, the kingdom is at hand. The kingdom is now. That created excitement. But it also created suspicion and opposition in other quarters. It also led to misunderstanding. Because of some incorrect ideas that the Jews had about the coming and the nature of the kingdom of God. And one such idea was the expectation that the kingdom would come suddenly and decisively. If you've been in my classes and haven't seen this, you've been sleeping. But this was one of the Jewish expectations. They thought the final intervention would be a one-shot deal. The day of the Lord, when the old age would be terminated abruptly and the new glorious age would begin. And you remember Luke 19:11, where the people supposed that the kingdom of God would appear immediately upon Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem. This is how they understood and thought about the coming of the kingdom. And in light of that expectation, Jesus' teaching about the arrival of the kingdom raised questions. I mean, you can understand that. The people saw in Jesus and his ministry, they saw something new, something exciting, something powerful. But there was a disconnect between what they saw, as great as that was, and the glorious state for which they longed. You see, given their understanding that the arrival of the kingdom would mean the end of the old sin-marred age, they questioned how Jesus could speak of the kingdom's presence when they were surrounded by the hallmarks of the old age. How can you speak of ushering in the kingdom being among us, the kingdom having come? How can you speak that way when I look around and I see sin, fragmentation, suffering, sorrow, and death? How can that be? And Jesus tells parables that addresses that disconnect. And one of the parables he tells in that regard is the parable of the growing seed, which occurs only in Mark chapter 4, verses 26 to 29. And Jesus says, the kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come. Now see, the kingdom of God is analogous to the entire scene that is narrated by the parable. In the parable, there's an initial sowing of seed that without any visible cause, meaning by the hand of God, ultimately culminates in the blessing of a crop of grain ripe for harvest. It culminates in an expression of the seed that looks quite different from its initial state. It begins, the initial state is this newly sown field, and that newly sown field winds up with something that looks very different than what was initially there. And the kingdom of God, he's telling them, I'm convinced, the kingdom of God is like that, in that the kingdom that is inaugurated, the kingdom that is sown through this complex of Jesus' ministry, death, resurrection, and ascension, it will, without any visible cause, that kingdom that is sown will, without any visible cause, it will culminate in the blessing of the consummated kingdom, an expression of the inaugurated kingdom that looks really different than the initial state. It will become that divine utopia that you are connecting with the kingdom, but you've misunderstood how it happens. the sowing will be there, and that sowing will produce that. You see, and that will look very different. So when you're saying, how can this be that we hear you saying kingdom and we have these expectations? So he's telling them the parable to help them understand that. There's a New Testament scholar, C.E.B. Cranfield. He's dead now. But he summarizes the point of the parable this way. He says, as seed time is followed in due time by harvest, so will the present hiddenness and ambiguousness of the kingdom of God be succeeded by its glorious manifestation. You may be saying, what do you mean hiddenness and ambiguousness? Just look around. Who gets sick? Who dies? Who suffers? We all do. It is not as though when we become Christians, we enter into a bubble that is immune from the fallenness of this world. So there's ambiguity. You and I know, you and I share, you and I sing, but the world can look and say, I don't understand. There is a hiddenness about the kingdom now because we live in this overlap of ages where the old age and order continues on. And we are affected by it and subject to it. But there is a day coming when that hiddenness and that ambiguousness is going to be removed. That's going to be removed. Klein Snodgrass is a guy, he's written a terrific book on the parables, by the way. But he's a New Testament scholar. And in his words, he says about the parable, Jesus' ministry has inaugurated a sequence of action leading to the fullness of God's kingdom, just as surely as sowing sets in play a spontaneous process leading to harvest. Even if hidden and unrecognized, the kingdom is present and will be fully revealed in God's time. The point is not merely that the kingdom is coming, for most Jews would assume that. The parable asserts that the kingdom process is already underway with Jesus' teaching and activity, and that the glorious revelation of the kingdom has its beginning in and is directly tied to what he is doing. He is the kingdom bringer. The long awaited, from the very beginning, from the fall and the plan, mankind has been waiting for the plan of God to heal the fallen creation. He's been working through the people of Israel from the call of Abraham, working, working. When is it? When is it? And here comes Jesus. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. He's that significant. He's the kingdom bringer. Now you see, the kingdom's coming. It's more complex than the expectation that political subjugation, evil and want would disappear as soon as it arrived. That Jewish idea of the one-shot deal. The coming of the kingdom is more complex than that. Snodgrass comments, he says, from the parable, people would have to expand their understanding of the kingdom to allow for its not being so obvious and for some passing of time before it was fully in effect. You see, he has to correct this misunderstanding they had about the nature of the kingdom, as it is God who in ways unknown to man produces the precious harvest from something as subtle and unobtrusive as a seeded field. So it is God who will in ways unknown to man produce the new heaven and the new earth from something as seemingly insignificant as the ministry of a Jewish carpenter in a backwater of the Roman Empire. Just, you see, that's the parallel, that this unobtrusiveness, this kind of thing that looks unimpressive, but what comes from it? Life-giving harvest. Well, that's how the kingdom is. How can you say you're bringing the kingdom when I don't see? He's telling them, this is how I say I'm bringing the kingdom, because you have a false idea of how the kingdom's coming. I am sowing the kingdom. But as sure as I sow it, it is going to wind up in something that looks very different but is organically connected to what I'm doing. You see, this is the kingdom that I'm bringing. Because this is God's work and not man's, we can be confident in its accomplishment. Snodgrass says, the parable then is optimistic. In spite of appearances, people may be confident that what has begun with Jesus will lead to the full realization of the kingdom. Although they are not mentioned in the text, patience and encouragement are results flowing from this parable. As you and I know, as sure as we sit here, that as that harvest will come from that sown field, you and I know that from Christ's work and ministry of sowing that kingdom, that you and I one day will share in the consummated kingdom, that perfect reality where we will be there with one another as resurrected people in that reality where there will be no death or mourning or crying or pain. It is going to be like nothing you've ever imagined. And we know that because God is producing it. God is the one who is about it. Now, with many commentators, okay, I don't believe that the reference to growth in the parable is intended to teach that the inaugurated kingdom gradually transforms over time into the consummated kingdom, as if this world gradually morphs into the perfect existence where there's ultimate fellowship with God and man, and where there's no death, mourning, crying, or pain. I don't think that's what's being said. You see, it's clear from Jesus' teaching and from other teaching in the New Testament that the final judgment, the expulsion of evil, the resurrection, and the transformation of creation, those things will all occur in conjunction with Jesus' second coming. He will effect the consummation. He will be the one who brings about the consummation, which will be a radical change. It will be a heavenization of creation brought about miraculously by the power of God. So I don't think the growing is about, well, he's sown it and then it gradually morphs into the eternal state. I don't think that's it. Now, I think the parable and others, I think it uses growth, which is a gradual transformation over a period of time, because there was nothing in their common experience, which is really the currency of parables, exhibiting a sudden transformation after a period of time. You see, I think he uses growth because it's gradual, radical transformation over a period of time, because there was nothing that showed a sudden radical transformation after a period of time. Well, you got, See, so to me, the emphasis is on the contrast. You see, it's on the contrast, not the process. It's between the difference between the unobtrusiveness and unimpressiveness of the sowing and what results from it. And I'm not alone in that. G.R. Beasley Murray, well-known New Testament scholar, Murray says, most scholars agree. Okay, so he's at least, he says, most scholars agree. So I'm not only alone, I'm not even out of the majority. He says, most agree that the stress in the parables falls on the beginning and the end of the operation of the kingdom, and that the process that lies in between is ignored. Charles H.H. Scobie, in his book on the ways of God, an approach to biblical theology, he says the parables of the mustard seed, I'll mention in a minute, I'm going to have to hurry here, the mustard seed and the leaven do not speak of the gradual growth of the kingdom and still less of the triumphant progress of the church in history. They are parables not of growth, but of contrast. For they contrast the seeming insignificance of the kingdom at work in Jesus' ministry with its future coming in power and glory. Similarly, in the parable of the seed growing secretly, the emphasis is not on growth, but on the fact that with the same certainty as the harvest comes from the husbandman after his long waiting, so God will bring in the last judgment of the kingdom. It is God's work, and we are certain of it because he is producing it and he is bringing it about. Now, the kingdom of God has indeed invaded the present. The present, it was launched or inaugurated through Christ's coming. The seed has been sown. But that kingdom is now more subtle or less conspicuous than it will be in the end. See, it's relatively subtle, relatively inconspicuous now, but in the end it will transform into something that is spectacularly different and great, as spectacularly different and great as a life-sustaining harvest is spectacularly different and great from a newly sown field. You can't eat the field. You can't eat the grain. Maybe you could. But you see, I mean, that's the point. You see, that's the point. You see, so he's talking about that. See, contrary to the Jewish expectation, that one-shot deal, the kingdom comes like this. Now, I know you haven't been in my class if you haven't seen this. But to me, this is important. Many years ago, when I think I saw this from David Wenham, in his book on parables. And you know, there are times when you study and read and you see something, you go, boy, I learned something. And this is one of those things. And then the more I read, I see, oh, well, this is certainly not new. A lot of people are under this. All right. But you see, Jesus comes, first and second coming, he sows the kingdom, and then what do we have? We have this overlap of ages. That's the ambiguity. That's why we're subject to death and suffering, all that. But when he returns, all of that's stripped out, and the kingdom of God is the sole reality. You see, and that's God's work. That's what God is going to do. Now, the same point is made in the parable of the mustard seed, which Mark, he pairs with the parable of the growing seed. Let me hit this just quickly. He says, Mark 4:30 and 32, he says, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable shall we use for it? It's like a grain of mustard seed, which when sown on the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes larger than all the garden plants and puts out large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. You know, the mustard seed, it was proverbial for its smallness. It was proverbial for its smallness, and it was the smallest of all the seeds that were sown by Palestinian gardeners. The plant, though, it grows to a height of 10 feet or more, which, by the way, that explains the non-technical reference to it sometimes as a tree. It's not being literally called a tree. It's a plant or a bush. But it is so large that it can be referred to non-technically, as it is in Matthew and Luke, as a tree. Let me just give you Snodgrass's comment on this, and then I'll shut up shortly after that. He says, nearly all agree that this similitude addresses the implicit question about the unimpressive and unexpected nature of the kingdom Jesus claimed was already present. This is what I'm telling you. It raised questions of how this can be given Jewish understanding. He says, was not the kingdom supposed to be a mighty display of God's defeat of evil and the removal of nations afflicting Israel? Jesus' miracles are nice, but where's the rest of the story? You see, why do I continue to see sin and death and suffering and sorrow and my kids get sick and my kids die? What are you talking about, the kingdom of God? I thought the kingdom of God was when we lived on free of those things. Okay, he says, Jesus' miracles are nice, but where's the rest of the story? Such questions would have gone through the mind of many of Jesus' hearers, whether friend or foe. The mustard seed similitude urges, possibly warns, that no one should be put off by what appears unimpressive. Like the tiny mustard seed which grows to a large plant, so the kingdom is present, even if hidden, unnoticed, or ignored, and its full revelation with its benefits will come. The point is that what one sees with Jesus will lead to what one hopes for in the kingdom. The focus is on the organic unity between Jesus' present ministry in Israel and the coming kingdom of God. The end that everyone knows and longs for is already in the beginning. You see, it's not something else. It's like seed and harvest. It's in the beginning. It's just another form. It's another manifestation of what Jesus brought. But because they weren't tuned into that, they didn't understand. They looked at it as unimpressive and thought, well, seed's no big deal either, but what comes from that? And so that's the point. You see, he says, the end that everyone knows and longs for is already in the beginning inaugurated by Jesus and now at work. What is at stake with this similitude is a restructuring of Jewish expectation. The kingdom, which has already begun with Jesus, does not come with a glorious bang in the defeat of Rome. Rather, it comes unexpectedly, almost unnoticed. But all that is necessary is already there, and the end is present in the beginning. The focus on the birds dwelling in the branches or shade of the tree should not be lost, regardless of the origin of the idea. In the end, the greatness and benefit of the kingdom will be a pleasant and wonderful reality. You and I, as kingdom participants, we will share in the glory and wonder and beauty of the eternal consummated kingdom. We will hug each other. We will laugh there. We will sit there and say, do you remember sitting in these places? Do you remember out there listening to sermons, classes, all that? Do you remember? Yeah! It'll be a party like you've never seen. Nothing but joy. Nothing but joy. Now, how do you know that? I know that because the one who's doing it is the same one who brings the crop out of the seed. It's God. It's God, and I can rest assured. As I love to tell people, I said, Christians never see each other for the last time. Never. And I love that. All right, it's our privilege to participate in the kingdom of God through baptism into Jesus Christ. That is our privilege. See, whatever struggles and questions that we may experience in the kingdom's present manifestation. And we do have, you know, you have these things about why me, Lord, and why this, right? You've all heard those kinds of questions, and you've experienced them yourself. It is because of the ambiguity of our experience. See, so whatever struggles and questions we may experience in the kingdom's present manifestation, we will one day, as participants in that kingdom, experience the unimaginable blessings of its final and complete manifestation. We will spend eternity in the very presence of God as resurrected people in the new heavens and new earth, a state in which there will be no death, no mourning, no crying, and no pain. It will be pure love and fellowship and absolute satisfaction. When people talk about, well, do you think you'll get bored? I just think, you have no idea what we're talking about. And I sometimes use this kind of odd illustration, like we're drug addicts. Sometimes when they first experience what got them, he says, you get to a place where I never wanted to leave. Okay, I'll take that. You see, there's going to be total and full satisfaction. And that's the state that you and I will spend eternity in. If we can help you, if you're not a Christian, if you're not somebody who has been baptized into Christ, a participant in this work of Jesus Christ, it would be our privilege to baptize you. And if we can help you in any other way, you know, you just need to ask. All right, come forward as we sing.